Jackson.
I will give that march an A. The African-American community did an awesome job with showing up and speaking out and sharing their feelings with our city leaders about the violence that plagues the city.
Now, you made a point of saying the African-American community showed up. Why?
Because prior marches that we've hosted, majority of the people that assembled were the Caucasian population. And this march was really astonishing with the African-American community presence.
And so the African-American community, in your estimation, is now getting involved, stepping up its energy and its presence in the fight against crime. What does that mean to you?
It means a lot to me and the community. On Friday, it was emotional. Victim families came. They had pictures of their loved ones that they lost. And it makes a statement that we're tired and we need to do something. And we can't just sit at home and cry and complain without moving forward and making some effort to do something in response to the crime that happens.
Ms. Shavers, your brother was murdered, one of the victims that was being commemorated during this march.
Yes.
What was the message that you wanted to make here?
Well, personally, I just wanted to share with my citizens that, you know, I'm fed up. So I think that we all should be to the point where we're all fed up to where this is just unacceptable. Mayor Landrieu made a point that violence has become natural, you know, in our city, and we need to get it to the point where it's unnatural. And I feel as though we as New Orleanians, we adapt so easily to different situations. Some situations is good, some bad. In this situation, we should not adapt to violence, and that's what we've done. We've adapted to being the murder capital of the world, and that's just unacceptable.
So how do we unadapt ourselves? How do we remove ourselves, extricate ourselves from this adaptation, this acceptance of violence and murder?
Well, honestly, I don't think that anyone has the exact answer to that question, because we wouldn't be dealing with the violence and the crime that we're dealing with today. But I do believe that what we're doing as an organization and what, you know, the movements that people are doing every day, we're one step closer to reaching our goal with unadapting ourselves from, you know, this horrendous situation. It's just unacceptable.
What's the difference now when you first marched? What's the difference now than when you first marched? Here it is 3 years later, following your first march. What's changed, Ms. Jackson?
Honestly, I can't really depict a change per se. The march initially we did was post-Katrina. Many citizens were in the rebuilding phase. They were not working. So we were all distraught. And with the murder of Denaro Chavis and Ms. Helen Hill, those cultural icons, people were affected by that. However, 3 years later, we are still impacted by the violence. We didn't have the amount of residents we have now 3 years ago, and yet we're still in the same situation. So it turns a red light on for me and other individuals as well. We need to do something. As Nikita said, it's no one solution, but we need to find a strategic plan to approach the issues that we have with crime in this city.
How's that working in terms of leadership? What's the leadership doing that pleases you, and what might there be about the leadership that displeases you, Ms. Shavers?
Well, looking at the leadership now in comparison to the leadership 3 years ago, I think that, you know, they deserve a chance, pretty much. I think it's workable. It's fixable. But we need to do more. They need to do more. You know, one point that Tamara made through at the march was, I want you to understand how crime is affecting our communities, how it's affecting our families. Treat every crime as though it was someone related to you. And that's something that our leaders are not doing. They don't feel the pain that we're feeling as a community and as citizens.
What do you mean? Could you give me an example?
Certain instances, our mayor, from my understanding, takes the time to visit the families and to visit, you know, the different cases or what have you. But I feel as though every individual should be treated with that same treatment and that same respect. The emotional side, that connection, the mayor should share with every victim, every victim's family, regardless of the situation. And I understand that because our crime rate is so high, that may be utterly impossible for the mayor to take his schedule and devote to, you know, every criminal. But that's the problem. Our crime rate shouldn't be that high. So that should be, you know, make an effort for everyone to bring the crime rate down.
How's it with working with the police in the communities where crime is most prevalent? Are the police officers helping, or are they hampering the crime fighting effort?
I can say in Central City, Captain Baldy has done a wonderful job in working with the Central City community. Some districts need some cultural and sensitivity training. The first district has done a wonderful job with their officers in coming out when we host our peace walks. Certain districts send their officers out and they walk with the citizens of that community opposed to riding in their patrol cars. And that makes a difference. It builds confidence and trust within the community to engage with the officers walking with them. In the 6th District and 1st District, I can honestly say they've done a wonderful job with making sure that happened. But overall, we're not where we used to be, but we still have some issues we need to resolve, because sometimes there is a hindrance with some officers and they get off on the wrong foot with the citizens in that community. And all it does is just hamper our progress with what we're trying to move forward with.
Give me an example, Ms. Shavers, where there might be a problem with a police officer or a certain district where cultural sensitivity training is concerned.
The best example I could think of was the day of the march. We had a motorcade plan that was highly advertised. You know, we went through protocol, every channel to make this possible. And I ran into a problem with NOPD officers at the motorcade saying that the permit wasn't properly filled out to have a motorcade. And, you know, all of these cars who were assembled to protest against anti-violence and the motorcycles and all of these people could not become a part of the motorcade because the permit was not properly filled out. Are you serious? You know, protocol? We're worrying about protocol here? When, you know, this is a state of emergency. We have people dying every day. You have citizens who've taken time off from work and, you know, young people who've come out to show their support and to try to be a part of a movement. And you're going to tell me about protocol?
Well, how did you work that out? How did you resolve it?
We rode anyway.
You rode anyway, but was there some kind of resolution with the officer?
No,
or did you part with hard feelings?
Oh, I had hard feelings.
You had hard feelings.
Mm-hmm.
So how's this situation going to work itself out? Because you actually need the police.
We do. We do. And hopefully they can reach out to me and, you know, I'll be here. I'm waiting. You know, I'm willing to work with the officers and work with, you know, NOPD because we need our officers. We need to build that trust again with our communities and our officers. And I've never had, you know, taking this position from this standpoint. I've never been that outspoken on the negative end. You know, I've never had a negative run-in until, the day of the march. So I just really feel as though some officers do need to partake in the, you know, sensitivity training.
You look like you wanted to chime in on that, Ms. Jackson.
I do. Being a representative for the Social and Pleasure Club community, frequently we have those issues. When we host our annual parade, some officers just don't understand the history of what we do and why we do it. And it caused the club people, as well as the second line individuals that follow, such bitter feelings when it comes to the police. And part of the silence is violence is we trying to build that trust within the community so they can communicate with the department and report crime. And you can't do that when you have communication barriers and people have negative vibes from the police department when they approach them in a negative manner.
So how much would you say, what percentage would you say that contributes to the violence in the that's taking place in the city of New Orleans, the lack of trust and communication between the police department and its citizens?
I would say myself, maybe 90%.
Really?
Many people that we've been communicating with on behalf of the organization, their issue, the number one issue is trust. They don't trust the police department. Well, if I call them, they're going to come to my house and Joe is going to know that I called. Are they going to share with the criminals that I called? So people are hesitant to give information to the police department because there's no trust there.
You get the last word, Ms. Shaver.
Yeah, I also believe it's a large percentage, maybe 90%, because, you know, for some cases that some victims that don't even make it to court, you know, in our situation where we actually made it to court and, you know, the witnesses were intimidated after we spoke and, you know, speak up, speak out, and, you know, witnesses took the stand and was intimidated and was killed and no type of protection, you know. So, of course, that breaks barriers, you know, and that takes us back with the movement that we're trying to
All right, I'm sure we'll be discussing this issue at some future date, but right now that's all the time we have. I want to thank you ladies for coming down to be
on
the hot seat. And you did make some progress, and that is you've gotten more African Americans involved in the effort to combat crime.
Yes.
All right. Sounds good. Well, again, thank you both for being here, and thank you for watching. Now let's head back over to the news desk.